continues. In Gazprom Neft, it's not a priority. We invest into the fields, and we try to develop non-traditional hydrocarbons development. And Mr. Fedun said that the main problem of our companies is the coefficient of extraction of oil and of oil production, and it's several times less than that in the United States, and we have a lot of ground to cover. And in alternatives, two things about alternatives, and it's a very popular topic. Sometimes they try to find something apart from oil and other sources, and to make the world greener and more sustainable. And you know, economically, these alternatives cannot supplant other traditional sources. And sometimes, more sustainable. The sustainable variants for example, coal generation and shale gas production in the United States, 190 billion cubic meters. It's a very big and it's a large topic, and it's sustainable, and it resolves some problems that cannot be resolved by alternatives. And maybe we should listen to the people from the state companies. In alternatives, I think at the areas where they have deficit of energy resources, that's the way, yes. But for other regions, maybe in our country, there are opportunities to develop alternatives. Those are distant regions, and maybe they could work something out. But I agree with my colleagues. And regarding the coefficient, it's not a geological notion. It's a function from economy. And don't be surprised that today the world assesses 10 billion tons of reserves, and our ministry says it's about 20. And with today's with the system we have, we sometimes cannot develop everything we want to. And so this coefficient is a notion from the economy, and it's a signal from the economy. The next question, please. Thank you. A very interesting discussion on volatility of oil prices and commodities prices, and the Group of 20 discussed it very actively. And how oil companies, what do they think about the situation, and do prices reflect the situation with supply and demand? And do you think that regulation of futures market in the United States impacts Russian oil industry in terms of long-term investments into the oil price? Thank you very much. A very interesting question indeed.
The answer is that in oil markets there's also a lot of politics, not only supply and demand. In particular, there is a producer cartel, OPEC, which has done a very good job to keep prices where they are. They have recovered after the crisis when they fell from 150 to 32 in 2008 and came back to where they are today. That wouldn't have been possible without production cuts supporting that. And so we have to realize as an industry that to some extent we live under this umbrella of this organization. Future markets in the US, we don't have any, many people have studied this. There's no evidence that there is a systematic influence over time, one way or the other. One word on what may influence prices in the future and technology. This I find a very interesting discussion. Everybody seems to agree there is a tax regime. Okay, it's far from ideal, but we have sort of to learn how to tweak it here and tweak it there in order to maximize production from existing fields. And I wonder if that's really what a tax system is supposed to do. And everybody seems to agree that it's not good enough to make for investments in technology and in the future. And I have a simple question. When I look at where all these technologies come from, where do they come from? Shale oil, Canada. Shale gas, the US. Deep water, Brazil, the US, probably West Africa, Angola. Alternatives, biofuels, Brazil, the US. You can, and shale oil, again, the US now. You can look wherever you want. I don't think it's an accident that all these technologies come more or less either from North America or from markets like Brazil, which are probably the most competitive and the most open upstream markets in the world. And I think there's a very simple lesson here. Technology doesn't fall from the sky. It's created by competition, by companies developing new things because they're forced to. Shale gas wasn't developed by some government program. It was very, and not by big oil companies. It was small companies trying to find a way to produce gas, new technologies in response to high prices. Many of them lost their shirt in the process. The big guys, BP, Exxon, all these guys, came in only later and bought them when the new technologies were already there. And I think this is important. Technology comes from competition, and you know, you have a tax system to support a competitive upstream environment, not to tweak it here and tweak it there and to hope that this will somehow determine the future.
Thank you. Two short questions. We're going to have much time, please. Two short questions. A small question. Invest Business Group, a question to all panelists. Today, Western oil companies sometimes cooperate with our direct oil suppliers. Do you think such cooperation is efficient, and which model is the most adequate here? Colleagues, please. Colleagues, just a short answer. I think all Western companies who want to buy from Russia, they are already there. They did what they wanted, and if the companies started doing it now, they are not very professional. And long-term contracts, in terms of long-term contracts, they are all in place, and the oil industry started years ago. And the last question, please. No last question. Dear colleagues, I think the discussion was very interesting, and we covered all problems within Russia and abroad, and the topics we articulated, they are not new to the industry, oil industry, but what I would like to say, I think new instruments are to come, and financial instruments to create new technologies, and maybe creation, for example, Western companies, they know how to do it, to create venture funds for new technologies, but it's a completely different discussion, and I would like to say thank you to all panelists for your contribution. Thank you very much. Thank you.